All right, Tim, take it away with computer maintenance.
All right, so today we're going to be going over computer maintenance. We will talk about both Mac and PC. So if you're worried about that, no need. Also, remember that since we're talking about Mac and PC, some programs that I mention or some things I mention will be relevant to one but not the other. If there's any confusion in the slides, as always, you'll get them afterwards. But if there's any confusion you have, feel free to ask Mary or myself, or definitely ask me during this program. As always, as I said before, you'll get the slides. You will also get a copy of the recording. And one of the benefits of the slides is if you go to it, next year or whenever, if you want a refresher, and if we run the class again, the slides will be updated. So you'll have access to newer information if you check this. If you have any questions during, feel free to do the little hand raise icon thing in Zoom, or you can type it in the chat. And whenever we see those, I'll try and, kind of organically put it in. But otherwise, we will stop at various points and ask for questions if anyone has any, needs any clarification on anything. At the end, there will be time for questions. And at that point, that's kind of when we would do answer kind of specific questions or different recommendations or people's, unique issues that may affect more than just them. So definitely feel free to ask questions. It will help out more people than just yourself. So I have no problem with any questions for this class. And if you, like me, ask your best questions after the time period has ended, let Mary know. I will update the slides with any questions that, would benefit everyone. And then we will also be able to get back to you if you have any questions over email, or you can always come in on Wednesday. So this class is on computer maintenance, and we're kind of going to go over some physical things you can do to maintain your computer and some kind of software-based things you can do. A lot of these will be transferable as well to things like phones or iPads or other tablet devices. The first thing I always recommend whenever you're going to start doing any maintenance is to back up your computer. And this is purely because it's a lot safer and no one sued me yet, but I should probably just add back up your computer before you do anything to anything I say. So there are multiple options. We've actually had classes on how to back up your computer in the past. We can run those again if anyone wants. But the short of it is if you're okay with like a physical backup, you can get a 1 terabyte for $50 or a 2 terabyte for $60 external drive. You would plug those into your computer. Many of them come with software that allow you to or facilitate backing up your computer. They're very easy to do. If you have a Mac, it's even easier. So you can kind of buy one of those, back up your computer, and then be relatively stress-free whenever you're doing anything. I also have a link that you can click through to what I use. I know some people like, quote unquote, recommendations. I generally don't give recommendations, but I will tell you what I personally use. In this case, though, what I use starts at about $120, whereas you could spend $50 and get a very similar experience. So I would recommend, going with the cheaper option if you're at all financially inclined. First section is physical. So physical are just things you can see and touch. So visually, is your mouse dirty? Is your keyboard dirty? These are things we interact with on a daily basis. Make sure that, if your mouse kind of isn't moving properly, if you're not using a trackpad, if you're using an actual mouse, kind of turn it over and see if there's any dust trapped on the underside. That can cause a lot of issues. If your keyboard feels like it's sticking or one key doesn't work as well as the others, then you can definitely try and clean your keyboard. In a little bit, we'll go over some specific things you can do in order to clean these devices. The next thing I always like to ask is your computer elevated from the ground? So the way to think about this is you know, when you're cleaning your house, where do you find dust? And of course, the answer for me, at least, I don't know what kind of anti-gravity things people live in, but at least for me, dust is found on the ground. If your computer is on the ground, that means it's surrounded by dust. The way your computer keeps itself cool is it will bring in air into the computer and then output that air. And if dust is mixed in, eventually your computer is going to get clogged up. So you can really have a better experience with your computer longevity wise if you don't put your computer in a situation where it's going to constantly be trying to suck up dust. So computer off the ground, really good place to start. The next question, and this is mostly for laptops, but is your computer physically hot to touch? So what you want to do is if your laptop is on, just like put your hands over it and see if there's any like really hot areas. Depending on your computer and depending on the area, it can actually signify different issues that your computer may be experiencing. So some things that can happen is if your laptop gets too hot, it can occasionally get hot enough to start melting the soldering that's done to connect the pieces together, and then you can get a poor connection. So if your computer gets too hot, it can hurt you. It can hurt, you know, catch stuff on fire, and it can just kill itself. This is also one of the reasons why it's not recommended to like leave your computer in your car, because your car will get really hot if it's in the sun. It will then cool off. It will then get really hot in the sun. It will then cool off, and your computer doesn't really like changes in temperature. And the last thing is kind of related to, is your computer elevated from the ground? But even if you elevate your computer from the ground, dust is still an issue because dust is in the air. And if you hear like a weird sound from your computer, or your computer seems to be running really hot, or it's getting slow, one thing you can do is check your computer for dust. If your computer gets too hot, then it will start to slow itself so it doesn't produce as much heat. This is called thermal throttling. So if your computer is thermally throttling itself, that means it is running slower. So sometimes if your computer is running slow, it's because it is too hot, so it can't physically, you know, do more things faster, because that would overheat it and that would damage it internally. Next step in physically cleaning. So for your keyboard, if it looks really gunky, feel free to turn it upside down and give it a pat. I don't know if they still recommend doing this for babies, probably, but if you're burping a baby, you know, you don't want to hurt the baby, you just want to burp it a little bit. So just do that with your keyboard. It also won't throw up on you, so that is a huge benefit. The next thing you can do is you can brush it. So you can use something like a toothbrush, but there are brushes made specifically for that, and I'll show you where to get those in a little bit. But it will allow you to brush gunk out from the keys, and that should help with any, you know, typing related issues you may have with your keyboard. The next thing you can use is isopropyl alcohol, 70 or above. So the benefit of using isopropyl alcohol is it will get the cloth, generally microfiber, it will get the microfiber cloth a little bit damp so it can pick up dust, but it evaporates incredibly quickly. So you don't have the issue of that you would have with water, where the water kind of stays and then you need to let it dry for a really long time. The isopropyl alcohol will almost immediately dissipate, so you're able to kind of clean things very quickly. Compressed air, you can often find these in a can. And basically, this is really useful for laptops, or if you don't want to open up your computer, you can kind of find an opening and just spray it. You will be absolutely astonished by the amount of dust that comes out. So feel free to take this outside, or, you know, not do it where you prepare food is kind of my thing. I like to just kind of put it in an area where it's very easy to clean up afterwards. But you would just take compressed air and kind of blow it in anything that looks like it could be dusty. The next thing is a cleaning gel. It's kind of hard to describe, but it's kind of like Silly Putty, where it sticks together, and it also will stick to any dirt. So as you rub this over your computer or your keyboard or your mouse, it will pick up the dirt from all the nooks and crannies, and then it will come right off. The last thing, with or without isopropyl alcohol, a microfiber cloth. The reason why you use a microfiber cloth is, one, they are not harsh. So for example, you don't want to clean the screen of your computer with anything that's abrasive, and a microfiber cloth is not abrasive. And it also won't leave things behind. So if you use a paper towel can potentially start shredding, and then you get more dust in your computer. Here's an example of a cleaning brush, kind of what it looks like, in case you're wondering. There are hundreds of these on the market. I honestly can't recommend one over another because any one I use seems to do an incredibly similar job. So I would just go with, you know, what's under $12, $15 and call it a day. And then at the bottom of this, I have the link to an Amazon search for keyboard and brush. And all you would do with this is you would get it, you would then put it on the item you want to brush, and you would brush back and forth. One thing to make note of is if you apply a lot of pressure or you really want to get a deep clean, I would recommend unplugging your keyboard from your computer or turning off your computer just so you're not pressing keys as you do this. The next thing is a can of air. These are generally, you know, between like $3 and $7 at Staples or Amazon. And all you do is you stick the red part in, which directs the air, and then you just kind of spray it in spurts. And again, tons of dust will come off. So make sure you're in a well-ventilated space and, you know, don't breathe it in. This is what I'm talking about with the cleaning gel. It feels kind of weird. It's slightly liquidy, slightly solid, definitely not as hard as Play-Doh, but you essentially get it in a can like this, or just a container. You take it out, you put it on something, and you just kind of rub it over the keyboard or mouse or whatever you're cleaning, and it will pick up the dust. It will incorporate the dust into itself, and then you can take it and you can put it back in the can. After it starts to look kind of grody, definitely throw it away and get new stuff. It's not really that expensive, and it does its job very well. I wouldn't let it sit on something overnight, but you can just kind of wipe it around and it will pick up a surprising amount of dirt. So all of this can be done, all that stuff we just talked about can be done on the outside of your computer. So the next step would be to open the computer. Whenever you're going to open a computer, please shut down the computer and disconnect it from a power supply. And if you're on a laptop, some of them have removable batteries, so you can remove the battery from it. But either way, the computer that you're working on should be shut down. Some laptops, mainly Windows laptops, kind of have some ability to facilitate you opening them up. Mac laptops are a little bit less easy to open up, primarily because people know, or businesses know, that if someone is opening their laptop, there is a decent potential for damage. Sometimes opening up a laptop or a desktop will void the warranty, so feel free to check before you do any of this. So with the desktop specifically, you can open it up and you will physically be able to see the amount of dust that has settled in the case. You can use a vacuum. Please do not touch the vacuum to any part of the computer. So try and stay away like half an inch. This is because the vacuum can get statically charged. If something that is statically charged touches a computer component, it can destroy the computer component. I've been doing this for a very long time. I have yet to actually have an issue with using a vacuum, but it's very much a, you know, use at your own risk and try not to touch things inside the computer. The only other thing really to worry about is fans. So your computer has a lot of fans, and this is to facilitate and force airflow. One thing you don't want to do is you don't want to have the fans really, really spinning for a long period of time when you're either vacuuming or you are using compressed air to blow air into it. This is because the ball bearings can wear, especially because of the amount of air that's going to be impacting the fan. It can cause the ball bearings to wear unevenly, which can cause issues down the road, or it can actually cause the fan to start to make a lot of noise because it's improperly balanced. So feel free to just stick your finger on a fan if you want to clean it. You can always use the microfiber cloth or a Q-tip to kind of, with some isopropyl alcohol, to clean off the fan. And you will notice, just like a ceiling fan, dust will get absolutely caked on to your fans in your computer. So feel free to clean those. Isopropyl alcohol and a microfiber cloth, these two things generally are going together. Whenever you're cleaning with isopropyl alcohol or water, yes, you can clean with water. I don't recommend it because if you do it wrong, you can kill stuff. So isopropyl alcohol, don't put the isopropyl alcohol on the component that you're trying to clean. Put it on the cloth first and then use the cloth to wipe. Make sure the computer is off before you do that. Yeah. Light pressure. Some of these parts in your computer will be plastic. If you push them really hard, they can break or they can bend. So light pressure. And definitely don't use bleach. I've seen people try to use Windex on their monitors. That's a really bad idea. Your monitor has protective coatings on it, which do things like reduce glare, theoretically reduce eye fatigue, just kind of things on it to protect it from dust and debris. If you use a Windex or a glass cleaner, it will actually start to strip those layers away, and your monitor will look worse, or it could actually damage it and make it kind of unusable. The last thing to say in this section is you can use gloves. Anytime I'm using isopropyl alcohol, I do like to wear gloves. This is mainly because my hands feel really weird afterwards if I don't. So feel free to use gloves. You know, those the ones that you see at doctor's offices, those work great. Not, you know, don't use winter gloves. That wouldn't really help. All right, we're going to go into the not physical section. So kind of things you can do on your computer. Are there any questions about like physically cleaning things?
No questions in the classroom.
Cool. All right. So on to the not physical section. So the first thing I like to think about or look at would be the hard drive. Newer computers will tell you generally if a hard drive is experiencing failure. There is something called the SMART status of it. Off the top of my head, I forget what SMART stands for, but essentially it will tell you, your computer will tell you if your hard drive has experienced any errors. If your hard drive or if your computer starts telling you that your hard drive is failing, I would really recommend backing up your data again. And I would also recommend trying to get a new hard drive. This is less of an issue with SSDs, but they can still fail. So the next thing to do after making sure that your hard drive or solid state drive is working would be to check how much usage you have on it. In Windows, you do this by going to Settings, System, and Storage. And on your Mac, you would find this information by going to the Apple menu, which is the Apple icon in the top left-hand corner, clicking About This Mac, Storage, and Manage. One of the nice things about these tools is it will also tell you what percentage is taken up by different types of files. So for example, if you have a lot of movies on your computer or a lot of photos, it will say, you know, X percentage is being taken up by photos. So if you need to clear space on your hard drive, you kind of know in a general idea where you should go to look to clear up space. The rule of thumb I have is if your hard drive utilization is under 80%, you're good. The easiest way I think about this is think of a garage, right? If you have a garage that is 80% packed of stuff, it's really hard to fit more stuff in there. It's really hard to get at stuff. It's really hard to move stuff from one area to another. Whereas if you have a relatively clean garage, it's easy to move stuff around. So that's kind of analogous to the issues you run into if you have a high utilization of your hard drive. This is a Windows specific thing, but if your computer is running high on hard drive utilization, for a Windows computer, I recommend using Disk Cleanup. This is a utility that is on every Windows computer. It is produced by Microsoft. Apple kind of does this more automatically in the background. So as long as your computer is on overnight, it will run the cleanup processes such as these. So easiest way to get to Disk Cleanup is go to the search bar on the bottom left-hand corner of your screen or type or press the Windows key. And then you just type Disk Cleanup. You will then see the picture on the left, which is Disk Cleanup. I have highlighted the option to clean up system files in the bottom left. Once you click on that, you will then see the right image, which is Disk Cleanup being run with system files included. So the easiest way to think about this is on the left-hand side, this doesn't kind of delete or remove any system files. And it says on my computer as of, you know, 10 o'clock this morning, that if I run Disk Cleanup, I can free up to 579 megabytes of disk space. As soon as I hit the cleanup system files option, it can now clear up 10.6 gigabytes of disk space. That's a very large difference. So this will clean up a fairly, if you've never run this before, it will clean up a fairly sizable amount of space. So if you need space, run Disk Cleanup. If your computer is running slow, you can also run Disk Cleanup. It can end up speeding up your computer a little bit. If you're on a Mac, or if you don't want to use that tool, you can always use CCleaner. I have a link in the bottom of this slide. CCleaner is kind of a well-known kind of optimization cleaning utility. It does more things than just cleaning up temporary files. We can go into that at the very end if anyone has any questions about CCleaner, but it's pretty easy to use. The interface looks nice. So I generally recommend it over other alternatives. CCleaner does have a free version. You do not need to spend money on it. If you really like the program and want to support the producer, then you can get the, you know, the paid version, which will do more things. But for 99% of people, the free version is all they need. All right, so the next thing is heat. So how hot is too hot? So remember when I was saying that you can physically touch your computer and kind of feel if it's too hot or not? Well, what you're actually touching on the outside is not nearly as hot as it will be internally. So all of these are in Celsius. So the numbers are way more impressive than it looks. As a general statement, if your CPU, that's your computer central processing unit, is below 80 Celsius, you're good. If your GPU, that's the graphics processing unit, is below 95 Celsius, you're good. And if your battery is below 35 degrees Celsius, you're good. The battery is obviously more for laptops. And the reason why you want to keep the battery below 35 is one, anything above that temperature will start to degrade the battery's performance. This is, again, another reason why you shouldn't leave your laptop in a car, because it will constantly go above this threshold just sitting there if sun is on it, which can drastically reduce your battery's life. On the left-hand side, you can see what Fanny, I didn't come up with the names, and coconut battery look like for your Mac. And on the right, by the people who produce C-Cleaner, they also have something called Speccy, which will tell you what your computer's internal temperatures are, or you can use something like HW Monitor, and that stands for Hardware Monitor. All of these would give you the internal temperatures of your device. The other thing I really like about looking at the internal temperature of your computer is if you're noticing that it shuts down, or if you're noticing that the fans sound really loud, oftentimes the issue, or sometimes the issue, will be just how hot the computer is. So if you look at this and you see that, you know, the CPU is at 80 degrees Celsius, then you probably have a good idea that these things are either your computer shutting down, your computer's running slow, or your computer has excessive fan noise because it's too hot. And then you can kind of specifically know where you should look to make sure there isn't dust, or make sure that the fan near that part of the computer needs to be cleaned. As you use a computer over the years, you'll just kind of collect programs. You don't need all of these programs. So for example, if you download Adobe Acrobat Reader, oftentimes it will try and get you to install other programs beside Acrobat Reader. So your computer will just kind of pick up detritus along the way. So the thing I like to do is I like to check how much of my computer a given program is using. If you're using Windows, you can check this by going to Task Manager. I can show you what that looks like at the end if anyone has any questions. And then on your Mac, it is called Activity Monitor. To find both of these programs, all you do is you go to Apple or Windows specific search bar, type it in, and it will find it. What we're looking, whenever we are looking at Task Manager or Activity Monitor, is the items that are near the top. Oftentimes you'll see a percentage. So if you see something like Microsoft Word is using 80% of your computer's, of your CPU, or 80% of your RAM, you know that's really high. So what you would do is you would then exit that program, open it back up, and it should return to a more baseline level. So if you see a program that you don't recognize that's using a ton of processing power or RAM or energy or disk space, read, write, you can kind of dig into it further and think about, why is this program using so much of my computer? And the second question is, do I even need this program? So if something is using up all of the, if a program is using all of this energy from your computer and you don't actually use that program, you can just get rid of the program and then your computer will run faster. The second thing to do is to check your startup programs. So startup programs are programs that run when your computer starts up. So you turn on your computer, these are the programs that automatically open. You may not need all of these programs all of the time. So for example, if you use Spotify, you may not need Spotify to start up with your computer, because if you want Spotify, you will just open Spotify. So by reducing the number of startup programs you have, you actually make your computer start faster and it will run faster because it won't have all of these programs running all the time. In Windows, you can check startup programs by going to Task Manager, and then at the very top, there is a tab for startup, and you can see what's enabled to start up with your computer. You can disable things from starting up with your computer. This isn't removing the programs from the computer. All this is doing is basically telling the program, I don't want you to run unless I tell you to run. For your Mac, you'll go to the Apple menu, which is again in the top left-hand corner, the Apple icon, System Settings, General, and Login Items. So these are the programs that will start up on your Mac whenever you log into the computer. And again, anytime a program is installed, it generally wants you to use it. And if a program wants you to use it, one of the ways it does that is it runs automatically so that it's always there. But if you don't need it all the time, you kind of don't want that program using parts of, you know, using your computer's speed to run because it slows down your other programs. If you see that there's a program that you haven't used in a year, or you just don't care about it, or it's using way too much of your computer at any given time, you can uninstall it. In Windows, it's fairly straightforward. You go to Settings, you click on Apps, you'll get a massive list of all the programs your computer has. You will then click on one of them, and uninstall is an option. On your Mac, it's slightly different. What you'll do is you'll go to Finder. That is the icon that looks like a blue face. You'll generally find this in your dock. You will click on Applications in the Finder sidebar. That's the left-hand side. If an app is installed in a folder in the Applications folder, you can open up that folder and see if there's an uninstaller. Otherwise, you can just drag the application directly to the trash and it will be uninstalled from your computer. If anyone wants to, I can explain why there's a different process between Mac and Windows, but that would be at the end. So again, just uninstall the programs that you don't want or you no longer use. I see a question. Often when installing a program, I get the message may be used by another program, so I never seem to be able to eliminate the whole app. So there are ways to force an app to be uninstalled. If you get a pop-up that says basically don't install this, it's needed for something else, oftentimes this is to protect you from accidentally uninstalling something that's actually necessary for your computer. Sometimes the publisher will just put that message in there because it doesn't want it to be removed. So for things like antivirus programs, they're actually pretty difficult to uninstall. Oftentimes they will come, you can download a separate uninstaller that would then remove it. But I'd kind of need to know the specific program. So if you have any programs that you can't get rid of, just come in on Wednesday or ask Mary or I, and I can send you a link on how to get rid of a specific program. The other thing you can do is you can restart your computer. You can also quit all other applications that are being used. By restarting your computer and quitting other applications, that means no other programs will be open in order to be needing that program to not be uninstalled. The next step, honestly, a step people should be doing anyway, but check for malware. You can do this by using a variety of applications. So I've only listed one. We actually have a class specifically on how to use antivirus or anti-malware software. But the one I always seem to recommend for the past like 15 years has been Malwarebytes, and it has yet to make me angry enough to stop saying to use it. So you can use Malwarebytes. You would then just run it. If it finds anything, it will let you know. It will then uninstall or delete or otherwise remove the offending virus or piece of malware. You would then restart your computer and run it again, and you would basically repeat that process until it doesn't find anything. Apart from just not wanting viruses or malicious software or Trojans or anything like that on your computer, they also take up processing power. So if they're on your computer, they will make them run slower. Again, another thing, run computer updates. So there will be some times when an update will inadvertently cause an issue for your computer. But in general, computer updates will make your machine run better because they found an issue in a different computer or in a line of computers, and that update will then fix that issue. So it's not necessarily correct to think that installing new updates will make your computer slower. Oftentimes it will make your computer more efficient, which will inadvertently make your computer feel faster, which is nice. The last option is to start fresh. So basically what start fresh means is it will get rid of all of your computer's baggage. In this case, your computer's baggage is your data. So starting fresh will cause you to lose all of the data that's on your computer. So make sure it's backed up. One of the reasons why this is nice is it will get rid of everything. So you'll be right back to a brand spanking new operating system. None of this excessive bloat that you've collected over years and years of using your computer will be installed. And you start fresh from a baseline of, you know, efficiency and speed. Windows makes this remarkably easy. Generally, things on Windows are a little bit more difficult. So for Windows, you just go to the Start menu, bottom left-hand corner. You click on the System icon, which is a gear. And you go to Recovery, and then you follow the prompts. On a newer Mac, so 2018 plus, you will go to System Preferences and Erase All Content and Settings. Upper left-hand corner, System Preferences, Erase All Content and Settings. On a slightly older Mac, so 2017 and before, definitely if you have an Intel chip, it would be in this older Mac category. You would first sign out of iCloud, which is the first step. You would then reboot into recovery mode. The way you reboot into recovery mode is you shut down the computer, you press the power button, and then as the power button is being pressed, you hold Option, Command, P, and R. If you have all four of those buttons held down properly, your Mac will start up and it will produce a screen asking what you want to do. You will then click Disk Utility and Erase Drive. The other reason why you would want to start fresh is if you're giving your computer to someone else, or if you're giving it to for like a donation, or if you're just throwing it away. All of these methods can be selected to do like multiple passes to erase all of your data. Even if you trust the person you're giving the computer to, you kind of don't want to just give your computer away with all of your information still on it. This is because, one, the computer's a little bit slower that way, and secondly, you probably have some passwords saved on it, so you just kind of don't want someone to accidentally have access to that information. If you need more instruction, I can definitely go over that at the end, or I can go over that with people individually on Wednesdays, or you can search Reset Mac or Reset Windows Computer, and an article by either Microsoft or an article by Apple will pop up, and it will have like step-by-step instructions with images on how to do that. But again, if you go this route, your computer will lose everything. Even though Windows says it can do this and keep your files, don't trust it. Back up your computer first. You don't want to lose any data. Before we get into this last question, which isn't people's favorite, do we have any questions on like the software side of how to clean up your computer?
So Tim, I have a question for you. Would you just do the software and the physical cleaning when the computer slows down, or would you sort of schedule it on a bi-yearly basis?
Yeah, so I mean, some steps in the not physically cleaning the computer, you should be doing, you know, once a month or more often anyway. So like checking for malware or running computer updates. In general though, for everything else, I just do it as needed. So for example, the computer that's sitting right next to me on my desk, of course, because I hate the floor, I can see that there's dust in it. So at some point, whenever I stop being apathetic about it, I will open it up and clean it out. So it's kind of like a visual, how dirty are you willing to let this get before you clean it kind of thing. If it's bothering you, or if, you know, keyboard keys are sticky, or if your mouse isn't working properly, or if your computer, you know, doesn't look the best, then that's when I would physically clean it.
Also, I think I remember hearing someplace that you should never run updates on Tuesday. Is that a wise tale?
Yeah, so that's something I kind of say. I don't say never, but what I do recommend is waiting a day in general. So sometimes there's like a security update that's really needed and then you should get it that day of. But I generally view it as, you know, about once or twice a year, you'll see an article that either Apple or Microsoft has released an update and it causes issues to certain computers. So by waiting for everyone else in the world to hit that update button as soon as it pops up, it allows them to test it for you, make sure nothing's wrong, and then you can get it.
Right.
So you wait a day, Microsoft sees, oh, this bricks, you know, this line, this update, you know, absolutely makes this line of HP computers not able to be used. We'll fix that. And then by the time tomorrow rolls around and you go to update your computer, the update that broke things has been updated itself. So that issue should theoretically be fixed. So I recommend as soon as you see the button, but if you see that button on a Tuesday for a Windows computer, just wait until Wednesday to click it.
All right, thank you. Does anyone else have any questions for Tim before we go on?
All right, so when should you replace your computer? This changes based on if you have a Mac computer, if you have a Windows computer. It changes on if you have a desktop computer or a laptop. It changes based on how expensive your computer was, honestly, so how good it was at the time. So the baseline I use is, one, if your computer is running slow and it's impacting you, I would not necessarily replace it immediately, but I would start planning to replace it. One of the ways I think of it is, if you were to take a computer somewhere and ask them to check it out to, you know, make it run faster, you will be charged, you know, X amount of money. You could use that amount of money towards a new computer. So it's kind of like if your computer is 5 years old and you spend, you know, $300, $400 getting someone to make it faster, was it worth it to try and fix your current computer in that manner? Or would that money have been better served going towards a new computer? And that's obviously a question someone has to ask themselves. Or if your computer is running fine and it's, you know, 7 years old, I'm not saying you should throw it away immediately and buy a new one. But basically, if your computer can still get updates, that's a check mark. If your computer is old enough to where it's no longer receiving security updates from Windows or Apple, it's definitely time to buy a new computer. The next bullet point was, how good was your computer brand new? So if you bought, you know, a $500 Windows laptop, that will last less time than a $1,000 Windows laptop. And that's just because the $1,000 Windows laptop probably is faster to start with. So it will maintain that speed for a longer amount of time, whereas the other computer would get kind of clogged down a little bit easier. And of course, Mac or Windows. Oftentimes, Mac computers will outlive their usefulness by just not breaking, whereas Windows computers have a little bit more of that like quality scale where some of them are really good, some of them aren't as good. So, you know, for Windows computers, in my experience, you're more likely to have the computer break and then you need to buy a new one. Whereas Mac, you'll, you know, my dad still has a PowerBook, like a G3 PowerBook, which is old enough to drink. I have a Mac G4, which again is old enough to drink. So those computers are still running, they still work, but they don't receive any updates. Newer programs can't run on them. They're essentially, you know, it's impressive that they're still running, but they aren't really useful. So you kind of have to put all of that together to find out for yourself, you know, if you should get a new computer or not. The rule of thumb, though, is desktop computers. After 4 years, you can start thinking about a new computer. After about 10 years, I would highly recommend having bought a new computer. Laptops, it's a little bit different. They're generally absolutely fantastic for 3 years, and then feel free to look towards getting a new computer. But at around 7 years, they're going to start to show their age. The other thing to think about is your computer's hard drive. So if your computer makes it past 1 year, it's in pretty good shape for not having an issue that breaks it. Generally, if a computer is built wrong or if there's something wrong with its hardware, it will fail relatively quickly. But after about 4 to 5 years, your computer will start to inch up on the percentage of it's going to break randomly, in terms of, you know, the motherboard's going to die or the hard drive is going to have an issue. And those issues will cause you to, you know, lose your data and kind of be put in that predicament of, do I pay to get this replaced or should I buy a new machine? So if anyone has any like specific questions on that, I can answer them. But oftentimes, if your computer is on the older side, it makes sense to buy a new computer as opposed to trying to spruce up the one you have. And, you know, that's just kind of the society we live in these days. So
what do you,
neither good nor bad.
Sorry, your computer, you and your dad's computers are old enough to drink. Do they like whiskey or beer?
I mean, if they get online, they'll pretty much get everything that's ever been, anything that's a vice, they'll grab.
Okay. And one other question. What do you feel about service contracts? I know you can buy a service contract when you buy a new Apple computer.
It's really up to you. So service contracts or extended warranties are definitely something where if this is a business, if you're running a business from it or anything like that, it's kind of like buying peace of mind, which is nice. I kind of view them in the same way that I view an umbrella. Like, it's not supposed to rain every day, but if there's like a 50% chance of rain and I bring an umbrella, it's not going to rain. If I forget the umbrella, then it's obviously going to rain. It's one of those scenarios. That's also one of the reasons why I also like buying computers and electronic devices from places that have like a physical storefront, because I find it easier to get the repair done by going to a physical location as opposed to talking with someone over the phone, justifying if it should be sent back, you sending it back, it taking an indeterminable amount of time to get it back to you. So for some people, they're worth it. For other people, it's not worth it. You know, so Apple has a pretty good one. Dell has pretty good. HP's pretty good. Lenovo's pretty good. So it's kind of a, it's like a car warranty, you know. It's kind of up to the individual person if they are willing to pay the couple hundred dollars for the peace of mind of their computer. Plus, you know, if you get into the more expensive computers, it starts to be more and more worth it. Like, you wouldn't buy a $500 computer and then have a $400, you know, 4-year warranty on it. Because if your computer dies, you would just kind of buy a new one instead of paying that upfront cost of almost the entire cost of the computer.
Okay, thank you. Does anybody have questions for Tim? Just unmute yourself if you do. Well, this sort of leads us, this whole program leads us into the class that is going to be held on November 15th, which is all about buying Black Friday and buying computers and phones and everything else electronic. So I hope you'll all join us for that, because it should be pretty interesting.
And again, if anyone has any questions, feel free to email Mary, and she'll, don't let Mary lie to you. She knows how to fix a lot of things, but she can pass it on to me, or you can always come by on Wednesdays starting at noon, and we can take a look at whatever questions you may have. And definitely feel free to click on the links that I have on there, and any questions about anything that comes up whenever you're looking at that stuff, just let us know.
Great. Well, thank you, Tim.
Thank
this was
you, Tim.
Really informative. I appreciate it. And I will, I'll upload the recording. I'm going to send a link out to everyone who registered, as well as the slides with the live link, so you can use them. So thank you.